Good morning and happy Sabbath. I am Randy.
And I'm Pauline, and we're the Phillipses. It is our pleasure this morning to welcome you to the worship service of Columbia Community Center of Seventh-day Adventists. We pray that as you worship with us this morning, every member, every viewer will be blessed by this worship service today. Join us in praising our Lord and Savior.
I invite you to pray with me. Our loving Lord, we thank you for this special time. We thank you for the power of your Spirit that will be with us as we spend this hour in your presence. May we experience your sweet Spirit visit each heart, each life, each home this morning, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Hi everyone, it's Mika here, and I'm back at it again with your announcements for this Sabbath. Here they are as follows. On Friday, December the 4th, we will be having an agape feast, and we're inviting all of our CCC members and friends to please join us for this event. This will be a time where we check in with each other to see how everybody's doing, while also giving our time to praise and worship God. And we definitely want all of you to be there. And for this feast, we're encouraging you to please make your favorite feast foods, such as fruits, soups, and your favorite breads. You definitely won't want to miss out on this event. It's happening next Friday night, 7 p.m. Please, please be there with us as we enjoy this time together. Please look out in your CCC bulletin emails for the link for this Agape Feast event. We want to take the time to commemorate and honor those that we have loved and lost within this past year. This will be a time of honor and reflection and just to the memory of these people, and we would love for you to participate with us if you would like to honor someone. Please send us 3 pictures, preferably in landscape mode, no later than December the 13th, to this email, communications@ccc7da.org. One of the pictures will be selected, and we're also asking of you with the pictures to please include the person's name, their full name, along with their birth dates and their death dates, and then also your family's name. Let's take this time out together to honor those that we have loved and lost. We all know that it wouldn't be CCC announcements unless we take the time out to commemorate those who have celebrated this past week with birthdays and anniversaries. We want to shout out Adrian Westney, Jackie Armstrong, and Hercules Pinckney, all who have celebrated a birthday this past week. And we also want to celebrate John and Suzanne Woldrich, and also Ernest and Regina Williams as they celebrated anniversaries this past week. We hope that you all had a wonderful, fun day, and we are also praying for God's Spirit to fill you in this new year of your lives. Remember that if you want to stay informed with CCC's information, bulletin information, please go to columbiacentersda.org/bulletin and sign up for our mailing address list. Thank you all, and I hope you continue to have a wonderful Sabbath, and I'll see you next time for our announcements. Bye.
Jesus Christ is Son. everyone. My name's Joanna Twego. I am thankful for that I am still alive in this coronavirus. And I'm happy that my family is coming to visit me again. And I'm really happy that we all get a day, we all get a break from school.
Happy Thanksgiving, everyone!
Please join me in prayer around the throne of grace. Our gracious Heavenly Father, what an awesome God you are. We have so much for which to be thankful at this season of the year. Lord, it has been a different Thanksgiving for families all around this nation. Many of us experienced a sense of loss on a Thanksgiving day. Loss of the presence of family members and friends, missing from the dinner table, either because we have had to lay them to rest, because they are isolated in hospitals and nursing homes, or simply because of the danger of assembly during this pandemic. We pray that in spite of this, we took the time to still count our blessings. We pray, dear Lord, for your anointing on your messenger today. May each of us hear your voice, be blessed with renewed hope, and be energized and empowered to share this hope with others. Almighty God, bless each family. Restore our nation. Heal this world which you hold in your hands. We ask forgiveness of our sins. We ask for health, comfort, and continued supplying of all of our needs. We pray all this in the name of Calvary's Lamb, your exalted Son, our Redeemer, and soon coming King, Christ Jesus. Amen.
His hand. You told Moses. Jesus, take the rod in your hand, stretch it forth and walk on dry land. If you can use anything, Lord, you can use me. Use me, Jesus. It well. He took a shepherd boy called David with a sling in his hand. He took the rock with a sling in his hand. He flung the rock and the giant fell dead. If you can use anything, Lord, you can use.
And happy Sabbath, family. Once again, the Lord has blessed us with a beautiful, crisp Sabbath morning where we have the opportunity to worship and praise His holy name. I certainly hope that you had a wonderful Thanksgiving holiday. We certainly did, albeit done virtually, but yet we had the opportunity to pause and take inventory of all of God's goodness that we have received in 2020 thus far, and it certainly was a time of great fellowship and rejoicing. Before I begin today's teaching, Graveyard Religion, I do want to remind you that December is right around the corner, and each year we designate December as the Squaring Up with God month. If you have had times where there have been lapses in your faithfulness in returning your honest tithe and offering during the year, we are using December as a time when we can reconcile our accounts. Obviously, the Lord does not need our money. We need Him. And we have found, and I know personally, that when you are faithful to the Lord in tithe and offering, returning it to His storehouse, He pours out upon us fantastic blessings that goes far beyond monetary gain. So please, if you find yourself in that situation where you need to reconcile, please do so prayerfully and faithfully in the month of December. Also, we want to pause and thank Denise and Danielle Josiah for the wonderful selection, Use Me, Lord. I hope that that will continue to percolate in your mind as we go through today's teaching. So that will be our response to the message of today. Lord, we have heard, we are convicted, we now want you to use us. But before we begin our Bible study today, I invite you to bow your heads with me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful that we have listened to your command to forsake not the assembling of ourselves together. And now, because of the pandemic and with technology, we come to you virtually, but yet there is no restriction on your part, no hesitation. So please send your Holy Spirit to each of us in our respective locations as we open your word, that it will illuminate our minds today, is my prayer in Jesus' name, amen. Graveyard religion. This is a continuation of the past 2 weeks of the series that we started, A Call to Action. And last week we dealt with heart religion. But today we're talking about graveyard religion. Now you might be wondering, cemeteries are obviously the locations where we lay our loved ones to rest, where they now are sleeping in their graves, waiting until they hear the voice of Jesus Christ that will raise them to the resurrection of life. In fact, Jesus refers to all of his followers who died trusting in him as children of the resurrection. So it seems a little bit incongruous for us to be talking about or comparing a religious experience, our walk with Jesus Christ, juxtaposition to cemeteries or graveyards. But yet Paul has a special message that he wants you and me to understand, to grasp, so that this becomes a part of our daily walk. In fact, it helps to facilitate our daily walk with Jesus in this transformational process where I become more Christ-like, where I am able to receive the mind of Jesus. What am I talking about and what is Paul explaining in the scriptures? Let's get right into it. Romans, the book of Romans, chapter 6. And verses 1 through 4. Listen to what Paul pens to this church. He says, well then, should we keep on sinning so that God can show us more and more of his wonderful grace? Of course not. Since we have died to sin, how can we continue to live in it? Or have you forgotten that when we were joined with Christ Jesus in baptism, we joined him in his death? For we died and were buried with Christ by baptism, and just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glorious power of the Father, now we also may live new lives. So Paul is drawing an analogy here. He is showing symbolically of what happens as we come to a knowledge and an awareness of Jesus as we begin this walk with him. You'll recall that when you were baptized, you know the Trinitarian formulation. As the pastor stood there in the water in the baptistry, he or she would raise their hand to the sky and they would say, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And then you were immersed, buried in the water and brought up. We know that symbolically that this baptism represented the watery grave, where we are now going down into that watery grave and now coming up just as Jesus Christ himself was resurrected. But there is a literal explanation in this symbolism, this death that we are entering into is the death or the demise of our flesh, of our sinful nature. You see, there is a distinction between sin and sins. Sin, in the singular, is talking about the power of sin, that root of bitterness. The individual sins, whether or not it's lying or whatever, the list is very long. Those are manifestations. Those are the results of the power of sin. In order for us to deal with the manifestations of sin, we must get to the root of sin, its power from which these manifestations grow. For example, if I have the issue of lying, of constantly telling lies, and I go to the Lord and I ask him, Lord, please forgive me of my lying, I then need to ask Jesus to give me the power of his Holy Spirit that will help me to deal with the root of lying, which is dishonesty. It is the dishonesty that is lying in my heart that causes me to lie based upon obviously the external stimuli. If I am finding difficulty in being honest and true and I'm stealing from someone, then I'm dealing with the whole issue of thievery. So what Paul wants us to understand is that when we come to Jesus Christ, there has to be this death to the power of sin in my life. You see, too many times we have placed our emphasis upon the manifestations of sin, the individual sins. Lord, help me to stop smoking. Help me to stop lying. Help me to stop using profanity. Help me, Lord, to stop carousing or being unfaithful. I've got to get to the root, the power of sin that causes me to want to walk on the dark side. Even though I have an intellectual awareness of what truth is, there is still this irresistible power that erodes my intellect, my ability to know what truth is. It is that power. It is the power of sin that comes as a result of my choice, of my willpower, where I have decided to succumb to it as opposed to giving it to the Lord. This is what Paul then wants us to understand. So this baptism he is talking about here is a death experience to the element of sin. It is the demise of the sinful nature in my life. And in Galatians chapter 3 and verse 27, Paul gives us this remedy, how we experience this death, how it is analogous to the death of Jesus Christ. And I want you to keep that in your mind now. Just as Jesus was crucified on the cross, and you remember those 3 hours of darkness from 12 noon until 3 p.m., where the cross was enshrouded in darkness, and Jesus died and he gave up the spirit. Likewise, Paul is saying our sinful nature must enter into that death. But listen to what Paul says, Galatians 3 and verse 27. And all who have been united with Christ in baptism have put on Christ, like putting on new clothes. In other words, I am joining Jesus Christ just as he died on the cross. When I go into this watery grave in baptism, I am joining him in that death. And what is dying is the power of sin. It is has been arrested by him. And then Paul says, because you are now with him, you are now putting on new clothes. This is the process of justification. When I confess my sins and Jesus declares that I am righteous because his righteous death is now covering me, I'm putting on a new suit of garments, new clothes. There's nothing like having a brand new suit or a brand new dress, ladies, or a pantsuit. There is something exhilarating about that. Likewise, you and I receive spiritual ecstasy when we put on the Lord Jesus Christ. When I no longer have to worry about trying to earn my salvation through my good works, but because I am trusting and believing in him, because his power, his deliverance, his grace, and his mercy has now captured my heart. The book of Colossians, Paul goes into greater detail. Colossians chapter 2 and verse 12. For you were buried with Christ when you were baptized. There it is again. There is this symbolism. You're buried, you are covered with Christ when you were baptized. And with him, you were raised to new life because you trusted the mighty power of God who raised Christ from the dead. You see, in this verse, Paul, as well as in Galatians 2 that we just read, he is showing us the connectivity between being justified by Christ as well as being sanctified. When I'm justified, it is a legal declaration. Jesus is saying, because you have confessed and because you have repented, I am now applying my righteous life to you. My blood is covering you. And now I am restoring you into a right standing with God. God the Father now looks at you through the lens, through the life, through the obedience of Jesus Christ. And he no longer sees your sins. In the books of heaven, by the name of Gary Wimbish, and all the sins that I have previously committed, because the Lord has the book of knowledge and the book of life and the book of deeds that we have performed. And because I have been justified, next to my name, I like to think figuratively that there is a red line that goes through all of my sins, or God's eraser. And he says, justified, forgiven, treated as if he has never sinned. It doesn't make me holy, but it declares that I am justified. It declares, Jesus has declared that I am now covered by him. So therefore, my standing before God has been restored. But that is just one side of the proverbial coin of spirituality, where I have been justified. The flip side is sanctified. How then do I now live a daily life connected to Jesus? How do I receive the power to be obedient? Because I know that all my righteousness is as filthy rags. I also know from God's word, from Paul's writings, that you cannot be justified by keeping the law. It is the goodness of God. It is his grace. So Jesus justifies me. He declares that I am righteous. But now, as Paul tells us here in Colossians 2:12, he now raises me to new life because I trusted the mighty power of God. So in this graveyard religion, the power of sin, my sinful nature, is crucified on the cross of Christ. It has been arrested. And my faith in God's power, and this is not some cerebral, esoteric, theoretical aspect of our experience. No, it is the power of God that raised Jesus from the grave. Paul goes on in Colossians chapter 3. Verses 1 through 4, read with me. Since you have been raised to new life with Christ, set your sights on the realities of heaven, where Christ sits in the place of honor at God's right hand. Think about the things of heaven, not the things of earth. For you died to this life, and your real life is hidden with Christ in God. And when Christ, who is your life, is revealed to the whole world, you will share in all his glory. You see, I believe one of the reasons why we've had great difficulty and challenges in our walk with the Lord of remaining faithful is that we have spiritualized this truth. We have felt that this was just an expression, a linguistic expression, that something is a pure analogy. But here, God's word is true. It is certain. Paul is saying here that in order to experience this graveyard religion, you need to grasp the reality that you have died to this life. What life is he talking about? He's talking about the life that is ruled by the power of sin. And how do you do this? You think about heavenly things. You set your mind upon the things of God and not upon the things of man. I no longer become preoccupied and totally consumed with the pleasures of this world. My sole objective and aspirations are not rooted in the things that I can see, that I desire, but yet I begin to contemplate the message of Jesus Christ, the person of the Lord. I then begin to desire the power of God's Holy Spirit that becomes operational in my life. Therefore, there is this assault that the Holy Spirit makes upon the sinful nature and upon the flesh. He says, for you have died to this life. Now, in Romans chapter 6 and verse 6, Paul gives us another example. He says, we know that our old sinful selves were crucified with Christ so that sin might lose its power in our lives. You see, you and I do not have the ability to withstand nor counteract the power of sin. Now, we can change some sinful habits. I know that there are individuals who attended a five-day stop smoking clinic, individuals who go to AAA or AA, Alcoholics Anonymous. We can make adjustments. We can use the power of our free will and choice. There are things that we can do that can tinker around the external aspects of our personality and our disorders. But beloved, spiritual things are spiritually discerned. Man's nature cannot be rehabilitated in the grand scheme of things. When we're looking at the issues of temporality and eternity, here, Paul is saying that your old sinful self, that sinful nature, the power of sin, must be crucified with Jesus Christ. Because if that is not the case, if that is not the dynamics that we are experiencing right now, we are merely trying to improve our old selves. It's like retreaded tires, as opposed to having brand new tires. The difference is between, as we said earlier, sin and sins, the power of sin versus the manifestations of those sins. One of my favorite Christian authors, Meade McGuire, wrote this in his book, The Life of Victory. He writes, the great difficulty with the majority of believers is that they are trying to live Christ's life without first having died Christ's death. You see, this is why we stated at the outset that this death to sin versus stopping sinning that Paul talks about in Romans chapter 6 is a real experience that is required for the followers of Jesus Christ to go through. I have to deal with the power of sin in my life. And it's a power that is irresistible to human effort because we cannot counteract it. Only Jesus Christ can do this. And so if that death does not happen, the death to my sinful nature, and I go down into that watery grave, I go down a dry sinner and I come up a wet sinner. That death must take place before we can live the life of Jesus. Ellen White writes this. She writes, the new birth is a rare experience in this age of the world. This is the reason why there are so many perplexities in the churches. So many who assume the name of Christ are unsanctified and unholy. They have been baptized, but they were buried alive. Self did not die, and therefore they did not rise to newness of life in Christ. This comes from manuscript 148 that was written in 1897. This statement was written 123 years ago, but it is still pregnant with potency. And it is true today as it was then, because self did not die. You see, it's imperative that this old man dies. As I stated, the old man cannot be rehabilitated into a new man. We're not looking for an improved sinner. We're looking for someone who is brand new. Paul tells us this in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 17. He says, this means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone. A new life has begun. So there is no reinvention. There is no remodeling. There is no renovation of the old heart. There is a brand new creation. This becomes even more imperative when we're talking about family units, when we're talking about marriages and families, people who are blending two lives into one. There has to be this death to sinful nature. This underscores the importance, and you can see the connectivity of Christian education, of training up our children, starting as soon as they are, not even before they're born. I was going to say as soon as they are born, but even the prenatal influences. I used to have a professor some years ago, and he and his wife, they were believers of Jesus Christ. And when his wife was pregnant, he shared with us that he and his wife would read their Bibles together. And he would read passages from the gospel to the baby while the baby was in the womb. Now, there are some who feel like this is going a bit far, but my point is there is an obligation. There is this connectivity, this whole dimension of fellowship that comes into the process of being formed by Christ. Spiritual transformation. But all of it begins with first this graveyard religion, where there is a death to the power of sin, to my sinful nature, where I go down just as Christ was crucified, but I come up by the power of God. She also writes, or rather Paul writes, if you'll turn with me to Romans chapter 6 and verse 11, because death is the only way that we can deal effectively with the power of sin in our lives. Listen to what Paul says, Romans 6:11. So you also should consider yourselves to be dead to the power of sin and alive to God through Christ Jesus. So therefore, if I'm going to be dead to sin, does that mean that I will stop sinning? That's a good question. Paul is saying that you have to consider yourself dead to the power of sin. And if that is going to be the case, then therefore the flip side is that you have to be alive to God. So if I'm depending upon God in justification, where he declares that I'm righteous, he declares now that I have a right standing with God. In order to be alive to God now, that means I have to be in direct relationship with him. In other words, I'm not depending upon my obedience to keep me in a position of being right with God. And I'm stating that again because the scriptures tells me and tells you all of our righteousness is as a filthy rag. So once again, Christ is at the center of our salvation and of our experience. If I am dead, if my sinful nature has died with Christ on the cross, and Paul says you need to consider yourself to be dead to the power of sin that is in your life, how I'm able to remain dead to sin is that conversely, I am now alive to God and I am now depending upon Him. I am connected with Him. This is why we read. This is why we study. This is why we pray. This is why we do service. This is why we commune with Him. We're going through these spiritual disciplines because it is a part of this vibrant lifestyle that we have with Jesus. And He then empowers us by giving us the capacity to be obedient. So I'm not just relying upon my own task, my own ability, my own compliance with the laws. No, I am dependent upon Jesus and I am receiving His power by the indwelling of His Holy Spirit, who gives me the desire and the capacity to be obedient. This is what Paul means then in Galatians chapter 5 and verse 24. He says, those who belong to Christ Jesus have nailed the passions and desires of their sinful nature to His cross and crucified them there. Folks, there's so much in this verse that can be unpacked. And I know that we're just spending a few minutes together here, but I hope and I pray that you are writing these passages down and that you will contemplate, you will ruminate over them so that they get down in your mind, but also into your heart. But you're asking the Holy Spirit to enlighten your soul that will bring rich meaning, that you now are drilling down into these rich veins of spirituality and righteousness of Christ's word, so that the Spirit will take this and will grab a hold of your intellect, but also your emotions and your heart. Paul is letting us know that if you belong to Jesus, if you belong to Him, and maybe that's one of the first questions that you need to answer. Who do you belong to? When you take stock and inventory of your life, how you spend your time, what you spend your time on, where do you spend your money? Who is occupying the vast majority of real estate in your mind and in your heart? All of these answers, or the answers to all of these questions, will help to determine who you belong to. Paul wants us to know, and he wants the world to know, that those who belong to Jesus, they have nailed their passions and their desires of their sinful nature to His cross. Graveyard religion. When I see individuals to who are in constant battles, warfares with each other, talking about believers and the household of faith, have they experienced this death and this burial? Have they nailed these passions on the cross of Jesus Christ? Now, it's interesting to note that this victory that Paul is talking about here does not come as a result of our compliance, as I've stated several times already. It comes about because the Holy Spirit is given to us and He is working with us. This is why it is so critical that we spend time with God in His word. Jesus Himself said it in John 15. You have to abide in Him and His word must abide in you. But you have to do more than what the Pharisees did, because they knew the scriptures. In fact, they had the Mishnah and the Midrash, but yet they did not know Jesus Christ Himself. Now, the reason why this is so important, we always have to come back to God's word. You'll recall that what happened in the wilderness, and Satan is assaulting the body and the mind and the spirit of Jesus for 40 days. He is taking him up high on the mountain on top of the temple. He's showing him stones and asking to look and tempting Jesus, saying, if you are the Son of God, I need you to do X, Y, Z. Jesus was able to defeat the enemy with three simple words. It is written. It is God's word. And I want to stress this point. The word of God is absolutely critical in this graveyard religion, where there is death, a death to my sinful nature, where the power of sin is eradicated, it is arrested, it is aborted, and it happens on a daily basis. And it's because I am abiding in Jesus and his word is abiding in me. So therefore, if I'm going to have this graveyard experience, one of the spiritual weapons in God's armory is his word. It is written. And so therefore, it now comes down to, who are you going to believe and trust? Are you going to believe Satan? Because Satan's, one of his chief weapons that he uses is to try to get us to rely upon our feelings. He wants us to live and to have our religious experience defined by our feelings. How many times have I heard individuals say, well, I would come, but I just don't feel like it. I would come to church, but I'm not feeling it. Or when you've gone to the Lord and you've confessed your sins, but yet you feel like the Lord hasn't forgiven you. Beloved, Jesus says he will take our sins and cast them into the depths of the sea, and he will remember them no more. We have a way of excavating, or we go deep sea diving, dredging up, pulling up all of these old sins, sins that the Lord has forgiven us of. Iniquities and transgressions and infractions that have been registered as forgiven and blotted out in the books of heaven, but yet we keep bringing them up. All because of our feelings. This is one of Satan's tools. We have to rely on what God's word says. For we walk by feelings? No, we walk by faith. So regardless of how I feel, my hope and my confidence and my trust is based upon God's word, not my feelings. So even when I don't feel like praying, I continue to pray. When I claim the promise of Jesus Christ that his forgiveness and his mercy and his grace will cover all of my transgressions and my sins, Satan rushes in on the sidebar and tries to bring and drudge up all of this mess, causing me to feel that possibly the Lord doesn't love me enough or that my sins have not been forgiven. No, I rest upon the pure, unadulterated word of God. Listen to what the servant of the Lord writes in terms of how we should do this, of dealing with this feeling versus faith dynamic. She writes from Book 2 of Selected Messages, page 243. We should daily dedicate ourselves to God and believe he accepts the sacrifice without examining whether we have that degree of feeling that corresponds with our faith. Feeling and faith are as distinct as the East is from the West. Faith is not dependent upon feeling. We must earnestly cry to God in faith, feeling or no feeling, and then live our prayers. Our assurance and evidence is God's word. And after we have asked, we must believe without doubting. Faith and feeling are as distinct as the East is from the West. It is not dependent upon feeling, your faith. You see, Satan will work through your feelings. This is why she also says you must guard the avenues of your soul. Jesus says in his word, I will forgive you. 1 John 1 and verse 9. and chapter 2 and verse 1, if we confess our sins, he is willing and just and faithful to forgive us of all of our sins. So if this is what the Lord has told us, it is the enemy that creeps in like Darth Vader, trying to cast a spell or an aspersion or a veil of darkness over this truth and this reality. We cannot afford to go by our feelings. We go by our faith. She writes on in volume 1 of the Testimonies to the Church in page 167, God must be served from principle instead of from feeling. Confound not faith and feeling together. They are distinct. Faith is ours to exercise. This faith we must keep in exercise. Believe, believe. Let your faith take hold of the blessing, and it is yours. Your feelings have nothing to do with this faith. When faith brings the blessing to your heart and you rejoice in the blessing, it is no more faith, but feeling. You see, beloved, our faith grows stronger as we exercise it. And that is why we should not always be so fearful when we are brought into difficult circumstances. It becomes an opportunity. In fact, one of my authors writes, man's extremities are God's opportunity for him to demonstrate and show himself strong, but it also increases our resolve, and it shows us that the Lord is faithful to his word. His word is true. That's why you can trust him. And this grows as we go through this graveyard religious experience where there is this death to my sinful nature, to the power of sin. And my obedience becomes the fruit of me being alive to God because his spirit is now living in me, giving me the ability, the capacity, and the power for obedience. And I'm not depending upon my feeling. I'm depending, and my faith is built upon Jesus Christ and his word. As I get ready to close, another statement from a servant of the Lord. She says, what is the divine requirement I must meet? God requires the entire surrender of the heart before justification can take place. And in order for man to retain justification, there must be continual obedience through active, living faith that works by love and purifies the soul. Volume 1 of Selected Messages, page 366. It requires the entire surrender of your heart. Not 50%, not 95%, not 35%. The entire surrender. So the question becomes obvious. And it's not a rhetorical question, but it has to be individually responded to and answered by each person. Have you surrendered all of your heart, the totality of your heart, to Jesus? And his servant reveals here that in order for justification to take place, in other words, if I believe that Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father in a place, in a position of power, when I confess my sins, Jesus then forgives me and applies his blood, and therefore restoring me to a right standing before God, where God now looks at me, as we've stated earlier, through the prism and the lens of Jesus Christ, and he no longer sees my sins. For that legal declaration to take place, I must first and continuously have an entire surrender of my heart to God. That is the graveyard experience, the death to the power of sin and that sinful nature. So I have to believe that. But notice that she says, in order for man to retain justification, there must be continual obedience through an active living faith in Jesus. So in other words, my obedience, my compliance is the fruit of my connectivity to Jesus, who is giving me the power to to be obedient. And the motive for my obedience is my love for Jesus because of this marvelous, marvelous grace. Well, there is one more quotation that I want to share with you. And it comes from also Selected Messages, Book 1, page 397. As God works in the heart and man surrenders his will to God and cooperates with God, he, meaning the man, works out in the life what God works in by the Holy Spirit. I want to stop right there. When we cooperate, when I first surrender my will to him and I cooperate with God, he works out in my life, I work out rather in my life what God works in by the Holy Spirit. There is this collaboration. It is incarnational. There's a part that God does, and then there's a part that I do. So you see that it's just not me doing good works. It's just not me complying with the law. There is this synchronicity. There is this joining. There is this partnership. There is this incarnational activity that is taking place. I am merely fulfilling what God is working out through the Holy Spirit by being in me. It is God who has started, the God who started this good work in you will also complete this good work in you and me. She goes on and she says, and there is harmony between the purpose of the heart and the practice of the life. There is harmony. There is synchronicity between the purpose of your heart and the practice of the life. Every sin, however, must be renounced as the hateful thing that crucified the Lord of life and glory. And the believer must have a progressive experience by continually doing the works of Christ. It is by continual surrender of the will, by continual obedience, that the blessing of justification is retained. Continuous surrender, continuous obedience by the power of Jesus Christ. This is this graveyard religion, this experience of salvation that takes place every single day of my life. It is then that I become equipped and empowered to respond to God's call to action. All those whom he calls, he equips. He equips us through this graveyard religious experience, this death to my sinful nature that arrests the power of sin in my life. That I'm able to resist it and the power is arrested because I am now alive to God through this continuous surrender to Jesus Christ and connected to him. My prayer today is that God's word will restore our hope and our trust and our confidence in him. That we can trust what he says and believe that he will fulfill and complete every good work that he has started in us. Then I'm going to be able to be used by the Lord. If you can use anything, Lord, then you can use me. That's what Sister Denise sang this morning. My prayer today is that you and I will experience this. And if that's your desire, regardless of where you are in your walk with the Lord, but today you're saying, Pastor Gary, I see what the Lord is saying. I realize that I must give a full and complete and total surrender to him. I'm willing to do that today by God's grace. If that is your prayer, and if that is your response and your commitment, then I invite you to bow your heads with me in a prayer of consecration. Eternal Father, we are so grateful for your precious word, for the promise of Jesus Christ. I ask now that we will experience this graveyard religious experience, that the power of sin will be arrested and will be broken, and that we will be alive to you. You will give us the capacity and the ability and the empowerment so that we can respond to this call to action. Now, for everyone who has made this commitment, Lord, I pray that you will anoint us with an outpouring of your Holy Spirit in a marvelous way. Now, bless us and dismiss us from this place, but never, ever from your presence, is my prayer in Jesus' name. And the church said, amen. May God bless you today.
Now is the time for us to respond to God's love and provisions. Let us return a thankful tithe and give our generous free will offerings. CCC members may do so by using our online giving link on our church website on your screen. Thank you for being faithful as He is faithful. For those of you who are viewing our service for the very first time, or perhaps you have been viewing on occasion and have been blessed by this ministry and would like to support it, you can make a donation to the church by using your PayPal and or Cash App as indicated on the screen. Thanks to all for your support.
Thank you for fellowshipping with us here at Columbia Community Center. May God be victorious in your life this week, and we look forward to worshiping with you again next Sabbath.